phenomenal statesman, and he was a tremendous first president. But he didn't want the job as commander-in-chief. John Adams basically talked him into it. He didn't feel that he was worthy, and many of the honorable historians will tell you that it was as if he went and got a how to fight battles and skirmishes for dummies book. Obviously, there wasn't one of those books, but he tried to study how to lead his men, and he was horribly unsuccessful. They finally brought over a Prussian, von Steuben was his name, a German that came over, and he tried to get the Continental Infantry. But if you look at any of the Continental battles, especially if you look at Camden, if you look at Utah Springs, if you look at Guilford Courthouse, almost all of the battles where they went up against the British, the Continental had superior numbers, but they either lost the battle or they lost more men. There is no proud record. The only moment of glory for Washington was Trenton and Princeton, but then what did he do following those battles, those victories? He winterized at Valley Forge and essentially did not carry that momentum forward. But that's when the Patriot Militia really scored heavy victories there at Musgrove Mill, at Kings Mountain, and then they led the Continentals at the Battle of Cowpens there. So it was, yeah. When you study the individual battles and skirmishes, it was men just like you and me that really weren't patriots. They were frontiersmen. They wanted to be left alone. But when they heard the threat come from Lord Cornwallis's lieutenant, the British partisan Patrick Ferguson, who led his men into the demise at Kings Mountain, before that battle he had issued the threat that if you do not desist in your opposition, speaking to these backwater men, these over mountain men, I will march my army, I will cross your mountains, I will hang your leaders and lay waste your land with fire and sword. Well, you see, these mostly Irish, Scots, and Welsh frontiersmen, they had lived under the thumb of British oppression, and it would not stand. And so they banded together, and now they became Patriot Militia under the leadership of a whole cast of captains, of Campbell, of Shelby, of Sevier, of Clark, of Williams, and on and on there until October 7, 1780. They delivered that decisive blow. Let me tell you how outnumbered there were 900 Patriot Militia against 1,200 of the British. Okay, 900 against 1,200. The British had the high ground, which is typically a military advantage. They also had all the resupply. They had the French Charleville muskets and the Brown Bess muskets, all going up against men who had no military training, had never fought side by side, and most would never fight together ever again. But they had determination, they had resolve, they had the American spirit. They would not live under British rule ever again. And that's what brought them out of the mountains, was the threat. It really wasn't about patriotism, it was about their freedom. But, you know, we put it under the category of patriotism. And so, yeah, there's a lot to be celebrated in a story that most Americans have never heard, because the history books are all busy glorifying and lionizing a undeserving George Washington. W4OVT.